Hello, everybody, and welcome to Seeds of Liberty podcast, episode 28. You can find us on theseedsofliberty.com, our YouTube, our Facebook, our Twitter, all on that, theseedsofliberty.com. So before we get into our show, we're going to go with Jeremy for the BIPCOT NoGov license.
Yes, the Seeds of Liberty podcast is covered by the BIPCOT NoGov license. This allows for reuse by anyone except for governments and the agents thereof. You can find out more information about this at bipcot.org.
So today we have Amanda Bruce joining us, who is a newly, newly minted voluntarist anarchist. Unschooling mother of a 9-year-old boy and a 6-year-old boy. She's been a Seeds of Liberty podcast fan for about 4 months now. She was inspired, I guess, by our show on the Unschooling with John Moss, his name, right?
Yeah.
She's had somewhat of an evolution as a result, which is awesome. You know, that's we love hearing good feedback. It helps us, do what we do, and encourages us to keep doing it. So, really proud to hear that feedback. And she's also she founded the Indiana Freedom Forum on Facebook, so you can find her there. So Amanda, thanks for coming on the show.
Hi, thank you for having me.
It's very nice to see you here. We hear you a lot on we see you a lot on the Seeds of Liberty Facebook group, and I think the page as well. So it's good to finally talk to you.
Yeah.
So can you get into maybe your evolution? We always like to start off with, how people, got started on the path of learning about liberty and voluntarism, what inspired them.
Yeah, so, okay, I look at it as kind of like a journey. I wouldn't say like it started when I heard you guys the first time or...
Yeah, I know,
you guys introduced me to anarchy, but... I think maybe a couple years ago when I quit my very, very stressful job, and I started, learning things because I had more time, it was food that actually kind of got me to rethink my stance on like government, because I used to get migraines like 5 days a week, and I had two small kids that I couldn't really care for. The way that they should be cared for. And I started doing research on why I was getting so many migraines. And I had been on a low fat, fake sugar diet. And I changed my whole diet and I went paleo. And within a week, my life was just completely different. And I started just like realizing that the recommendations that are set by the U.S. government and the FDA, they're not in my best interest. And I kind of got on board with the whole like March Against Monsanto, and I thought of myself as real left, and since then I've realized that like government and big business, pharmacy, everything, they're all like intertwined. And so I don't really prescribe to that anymore. But yeah, I started researching medical things because with diet, it made sense to be aware of everything that I'm putting in my body, not just food, but if I'm taking antibiotics that are throwing my whole system off, or I started researching homeschooling. That came from just a couple years of my son having a really bad time, and having just our home life was just very, very stressful. We would get up in the morning and we would fight to get up and get ready for school, and I'd send him to school, I'd go to work, come home, pick him up, and fight over homework, fight over showers, fight over bedtime, fight over reading, and that was our life, and it just didn't make sense.
It wears down on you.
yeah, and when you realize how that's affecting your child, like that's it's sad.
Yeah, I remember how my parents used to treat me because I'm not a homework kind of guy. I'm a hands-on.
Yeah.
You know, if I don't get it in the first pass, I'm probably not going to get it unless I want to learn about it. So, you know, my girlfriend always gets mad because, like, I used to, you know, I take tests. I don't even study for them, and I make an A. And she's like, if I don't study, I fail. And I'm just like, that's not how I learn, you know? Mm-hmm. So school, like, the problem with school is this standardization, you know, not everybody learns right. The same way. And, you know, that causes even more drama and stress on the back end because it's like the parents are like, well, you know, the government must know what's right about, you know, teaching and learning up those kids. But, you know,
they just haven't perfected it yet. That's what Common Core is for. Give it time.
Oh, yeah. They have not put enough money into it. That's the problem.
You just need a few more tests.
So you've told me in the past that I've said things that have made you mad.
Yes.
So I assume you're the only one that said that, right?
Well, I mean, there's a long list, but wow. She's here now.
I can't pinpoint anything like specifically. It was just like I said, I considered myself like very, I guess, left. And even when I started, you know, talking with you guys, I said, well, I don't know. I can't call myself an anarchist. Because, I care about people.
That's right. We hate everybody. Poor children. Hate them all.
It's like we hate people so much that we want to get rid of the institution that steals and kills everybody.
Yeah.
That's how much we hate people.
We hate them so much we just want them to be free.
Damn bastards.
It's hard because I consider myself like a very successful product of government school. Like I graduated the top of my class, I got all A's, I, you know, did what I was supposed to do all through school. So I mean, it's hard when you've been taught your whole life what to think, and then someone else comes in and is saying, well, that's not right. You're being emotional. you need to think. And it's cognitive dissonance is what it is.
Well, you know it's very encouraging to hear you say that you were in the top of your class and yet you rethought those things that you learned. That's
go ahead.
That I memorized, not learned.
Yeah, no, but I'm saying it's those people that are most resistant most of the time because they're the ones that, you know, follow, you know, what they're supposed to do, and even not only follow but exceed the expectation of their teachers and do more mindless regurgitation.
Go ahead. I my mom had a lot to do with that because she really stressed for like high test scores and good grades and stuff, but at the same time, like, she was always really really relaxed about like the pointless rules. I got in trouble a lot in school, and it was nothing. I wasn't a troublemaker. I remember one time I got a detention because I wore gloves in school, like things like that. And a lot of kids, you know, they would go home and, you know, they would have a detention and then they would go home and they would have their parents yelling at them on top of that. And I didn't have that. My mom just laughed. She, you know, she realized this is not something I need to waste my time on, you know? So I thank her for that.
Yeah, it sounds like you have a cool mom. So you said you were kind of a left leaning person. Was it mostly like social stuff that was pushing? I feel like a lot of leftists have good intentions in their head, or I mean in their heart, but not in their head.
Yeah.
And you know what anarchists and voluntarists and people who support the idea of individual freedom tend to do is push more rational and, you know, well thought out plans. And that's where the leftists, you know, like the pie in the sky stuff, you know, like Bernie Sanders is up here saying, you know, I want free healthcare for everybody. I want to do this. I want to do that. Mm-hmm. It's like, well, when the rubber meets the road, you don't have the money to do that, bud. So like there's this, always this backlash for leftists that their ideas sound great. Some of them sound great on paper, but they're not logistically or physically possible. You know, it's like there's not enough wealth in the world for everybody to have a nice house and a good paying job and all, you know, it just doesn't, it does, that's not reality. And you know, like Bernie Sanders isn't going to fix the job problem in America. Oh, hey, minimum wage is $30 an hour, but hey, there's no jobs. So well,
he doesn't plan on fixing it because people, the people pushing that stuff know, also know that it won't work, that it's not feasible. They know that. They just push it because they depend on the people who don't know any better, who honestly think it can happen, to support them and carry them to victory.
Yeah, single issue voters, you know, like go out there, you say, hey, oh, we're gonna.
It's not even the single issue voters. It's just a lot of the leftists in general, the SJW crowd. They get swept up because they don't know any better. But Bernie Sanders knows damn well that he can't give free healthcare or free this or free college or free. He knows damn well it's not free.
Did you ever see the video with Jan Hedfield and Bernie Sanders?
No.
It's great. You need to watch it. One of you needs to put it in the show notes. It's a short little video, but I don't want to spoil it. But so you had all this cognitive dissonance like slamming you in the face when you found our show. But what made you keep listening? What was like, are these guys right? Was it like, are these guys right? Or
A lot of it did make sense.
It was the beard. It was the beard.
No, a lot of it made sense to me. It was just like once in a while you guys would like you would throw a punch in there. It was like, wait a second. Like, well, how can you say that?
The Howard Stern effect. You listen even if you don't like us because you want to hear what Dave's going to say next.
Sometimes like you know, the tiger's asleep in the cage and yelling at it don't wake it up and you got to kick the cage, you know? So pardon me for a bad analogy, but sometimes you gotta slap somebody to wake them up, you know. We're not like trying to be Christopher Cantwell here or anybody and like just try to shock everybody with what we're saying. We're just, you know, every so often you have to interject something into an idea to make people make it click. And I know you've messaged me on certain occasions. You've said, wow, when you said that, like, it literally blew my mind. Like, I never thought of that. And it's like, sometimes you just need to hear something.
Yeah.
And it's very hard to fight that cognitive dissonance when it starts piling up. Like, you can for a little while if you dismiss it and bury your head back down in the sand. But if you keep digging, it goes away. And it's that's what a lot of people lack, is that fortitude to keep digging.
Right. Yeah. Like I said, that's why I see it as kind of a journey, because maybe a year ago, if I would have heard you guys, I would have, you know, chalked it up to just like, oh, these guys are assholes or, oh, sorry. I don't know. If
yeah, it's okay.
No, you can't cuss on here. Only I can. I'm kidding. You can say whatever the flying flip you want to say.
Dave's the only one we put a limit on.
Yeah. I went overboard last week, so I'm trying to tone it down.
Like I said, I saw what, before I heard you guys, I saw that, you know, I didn't trust government. I didn't realize that there was a different option, you know, because that's not what you're taught. You're taught that vote Republican or you vote Democrat, and that's your part, and, you know.
Yeah, you're either a chavista or you're a rebel, you know. It's like... Right. There's no rational, sensible middle ground here. That's, hey, maybe we don't need this thing at all.
Yeah.
Isn't that funny? Like, I think people constrain themselves to what's on the ballot. Like, I can only be either Democrat, Republican, constitutionalist, independent, Green Party. All right, that's it. All right, there's nothing else. I can't be anything else. If the government doesn't tell me that it's a possibility, then it doesn't exist. And I think we're here to say that's crap. Of course, there's many possibilities. You know, I guess if you just take the Republican Democrat, that would be the false dilemma, right? False dichotomy, right? It's just two sides of the coin, right? But no, it's a sphere. You know, there's many different ways to to interact with your fellow human being, right? And no one person has the capability, or as I think Larkin Rose put a Facebook post today about who's qualified to be president, who has the proper qualifications to run 300 million people's lives. Who, and how do you get those qualifications? And who determines what these qualifications are?
George Bush, man. We just got to get him back. He had 8 years in office. You know, just let him ride it out till he dies, and we can have an understudy. You know, Jeb Bush. We could just put Jeb Bush as his vice president, and they could just run it till, you know, till the end of time, until Bush's kids die in a nuclear holocaust with Costa Rica. Who knows?
Right. Yeah. So I mean, I was just talking about this today I was hanging out with this one homeschooling mother. She's more of an unschooler, and I was basically saying that when
Danilo and his ladies, man.
Oh, I know.
He's got them all.
I'm always out and about.
The wife doesn't get jealous,
or do you just... I mean, actually, there's one guy sometimes, but most of the time I'm the only one. Actually, I was at this one thing I go on Fridays, and it's usually a bunch of women, and then I come, and then they're like, you know what? It's so nice that you're here, because most of the time we're always talking about our husbands, and now you tell us about your wife, so that's nice to hear wife stories.
But, oh, Lord, and you got a lot of them, and your stepmom, and your mom.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
So, Amanda, like, what have you read any books, or have you... like, would you?
Have you ever read a book?
Yeah. Have you ever read any Dr. Seuss? No. Have you read any books we've ever recommended or anything?
Actually, this is what I was talking about of being a good product of the government school. I don't like to read. I try, and I have a hard time reading. I just finished John Taylor Gatto's. Which one was it?
Was it his is the underground history or his
weapons of mass instruction?
No, it was.
Well, I don't like to read either anymore. I used to be like a 100, 150 book a year kind of guy. I would just sit and read all day, you know, smoke a little weed, read. Now I like, if it's not an audiobook, I'm not listening to it or I'm not reading it. So that's the way I ingest books now, is like listen to it on audio, because I'm not one of those people that has to read it to comprehend it. Like if someone talks, I get it.
Yeah, I'm like that too. I get it better when from talking. So like, but yeah, I just finished. I can't remember what the name of it was, but he talks about like what he teaches in school, because he was a teacher, right? So he and I like it because it's very like factual. He talks about like how he teaches he teaches kids to be dependent on someone else to tell them what to do and what to know and how to work. It was just very, he took the language and he didn't sugarcoat it, you know, like, so there's a little bit of like statism in it reflected, but
of course.
But he kind of redeemed himself, I guess, at the end, like towards the end, because he talked about pulling your kids out of the system and
so what do your kids feel about homeschooling, like when you told them that that's what you wanted to do? What were their reactions?
They were nervous, and actually when we decided to homeschool, it was before the end of the school year. And I, you know, I was really wanting to do it, and I talked about it with them, and I was going to give them a choice. Well, I still gave them a choice, but like I told myself, well, I will be okay if they want to continue going. But as time has passed, I don't think, like today, if they said I want to go back to public school, I don't know what I would do. I would probably cry and try my hardest to convince them not to, because it's just an indoctrination camp. And
it really is. Yeah. And are they pretty happy so far?
Yeah, they're really happy. Our life has just turned around so much since
are you a more happy person? Because yes. I found that just learning about voluntarism and changing the way I approach things, I've just been a much more happier person. I mean, I just lost my job and lightning hit my house, and I didn't skip a beat. I wasn't depressed at all.
Yeah, for sure. There's like an inner peace that comes with it. You realize that you have this control over your life, and it's nice.
Yeah. Now, if my girlfriend got pregnant, I'd probably freak out. But that's a different story for a different day. I love making Danilo laugh. That's literally the only goal of me in this show, is to make Danilo laugh.
Danilo has a good laugh. Oh,
I'm a comedian, so you know how much laughter I do. So man, did you meet up like with other homeschoolers in your area? Like, have you found many?
I'm trying. We found one family that unschools that's not too far from us, and we met up with them once. And they're really, really cool. The dad, he runs an aquaponics farm. Like he,
ooh, the, nice.
That's cool.
And he also has, like, I think he rehabs houses in Gary. I don't know if you guys have probably heard of Gary, Indiana. Yeah. So like, mm-hmm. he does stuff over there. He's really awesome. Like he is, he's got this project going with, creating gardens out there, like community gardens. So that's really cool. But yeah,
sounds like a really cool dude. You need to hook us up with him.
Okay. Yeah, I'll add him to the group or something.
Have you looked at any like homeschooling co-ops? Because I know a lot of places have those.
Mm. Yeah, a lot of them here are religious, and
I don't necessarily think that's a bad idea. Or a bad thing, and I also don't think it's a good. I think it's kind of a neutral thing. It's all about your approach to the thing. Like, obviously, you don't want to be putting your kids into something where you're avoiding indoctrination by taking them out of the government schools. So you don't want them getting, you know, put in with Mother Mary or whatever. Yeah. You know, like, so, like it's all a personal thing. Like, but if like you found a co-op that was really strong on math, right. and one of your kids was really interested in, you know, math, it would make sense to get them into that co-op, regardless. Yeah. So, you know, and say, hey, look. You know, if you don't want to participate in any religious stuff, tell them I don't want to participate, you know?
Yeah.
Because there's a few big co-ops here in Alabama that a few family members and stuff that I know have put their kids through. And they're really good. The kids who come through there are smarter than any kid that comes out of government school. Like, it is insane.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah, we're still kind of, like, de-schooling. I don't know how familiar you guys are. Yeah. But, I mean, we were pretty authoritarian, especially with my older son. So he's taken a while longer to be receptive to suggestions. He really likes to play Minecraft. So
they're using Minecraft in college now to teach kids.
Yeah, I used to feel guilty about it, and I don't anymore. After just sitting down and watching and playing with them sometimes, they learn so much. You should see my six-year-old type.
Yeah, it's like, how do they learn this language? Let them play a video game. You'll pick up the language quick.
Yeah.
Yeah, they are. Video games are not. I mean, I try to keep my kids away from them, just because one of my daughters, it would, you know, she's prone to seizures, so video games kind of freak her out. But I used to think because I remember myself and how immersed I got into them, and I was just, like, I was one of those people that, you know, I was a hardcore gamer, so I took it to the extreme. And I worry about them, but then I look at it and I see some of my other friends and family members that do it, and they, you know, they don't, I mean, they're more statists, so they have, like, they're very regimented with, like, you have this amount of time and whatever, not just, you know, other people now that I've met, John Moss that we had on, you know, the show that you originally heard us on. He actually had said something to me about that, and I thought about it afterwards, because he said, you know, they kind of figure it out, that they just, like, they get bored of it after a while, and then they want to go do something else. And I was like, oh yeah, I never gave myself that opportunity, because I was in school all the time, and I was. Mm-hmm. It's funny, you to go back to something you were saying earlier about how, you know, you were the really good student, you had, you know, really good grades. That was me too. I was, you know, and both my parents were teachers.
So they helped you with your homework. Got it.
Yeah, exactly. No, I was a very good student. We have
a Seas of Liberty drinking game now going. Okay, every time I make Danilo laugh, every time I say fascism, anytime Jeremy goes for a puff on his. On it, because if you did it on me, you would be drunk as hell.
Well, that's not fair, because then people listening to the podcast can't play the game, because they can only hear.
Oh, if you're listening, start watching as well.
But anyway, as I was saying, you know, I was that kid too, so so all I did when I had free time, which was very little, because I did my homework and I did all my reports and I did all that stuff. So whatever little free time I had, I filled it all with video games, and I didn't care about anything else. Mm-hmm. I wasn't taking into account that my kids are like, no, they have other things they like to do, and it's, you know,
are you playing Super Mario Kart?
Never got into that game.
Oh, man.
But anyway, no, so I see what you're saying. The de-schooling makes sense. I mean, I'm lucky. I'm somebody who my kids are, you know, they're only four right now, so we don't have to go through that process. They're going to start off that way. But
right.
I mean, what was your oldest was what, in third grade then?
He finished third grade.
Okay, yeah.
In government school.
So. Yeah, so that's, you know, 3 years plus kindergarten. That's, you know, it's a lot.
Plus,
to...
really, I mean, they were allowed 30 minutes of electronics per day, and that was all electronics, but they also had to earn it. Like, that's how much of a douchebag I was.
So are they, let me ask you a question. This is going to be an honest question a lot of people are going to ask. Are they behaving better now?
Oh, my gosh, yes. Yes.
Like when
sure.
you ask them, hey.
Define that behaving better.
Hey, oldest son, can you go do a load of laundry? You know, will they do it for you?
It depends. Sometimes they'll do things, and they're more receptive if I'm going to help them do it. Sometimes they say no. Sometimes they'll ask me if they can wait, you know, till they finish their level or something. It just it depends on their mood, which, I mean, I don't blame them, because if I'm not feeling like going and doing laundry, I'm not going to go do laundry, and I give them that same respect.
Yeah. What about I think at some point, I mean, under the current paradigm, at some point you're eventually going to have to train them up for a GED, to take the GED, right?
No, actually, Indiana is pretty, pretty lax about homeschool.
I'm talking about them for like, you know, getting a job. Like if you go,
oh, yeah.
you know, you turn 20, you go into a job and you're like, yeah, I only finished third grade.
Yeah.
You know, if it was an anarchist, they'd be like, oh, that's awesome. But if it's, you know,
well, no, you can, I don't even think you have to necessarily, well, it depends on the state, I guess, but that you can test out where,
well,
I don't think
Indiana,
it's an actual GED. It just depends on your state, I guess.
In Indiana, homeschool parents can issue a diploma.
Oh, okay. You can do your own. Okay.
That's cool. Nice.
Yeah. Wow. That's a blowout. That's awesome.
that's
I
funny.
I have not found one state that I will move to because of that.
See, that's funny. Didn't they? Because I'm trying to remember. Because right before I finally succumbed to anarchism, I was involved when I was still a minarchist. I was very heavily.
You
involved
succumbed? In No. You need to look up the word succumb. That doesn't fit. That's like you succumb to a rapist. You don't.
It was sarcasm, Dave. Relax, buddy. Anyway,
I'm only going for Danilo laughs here. Okay.
You guys want to have a private conversation? You want to get a room? All right. I was very involved in the anti-Common Core movement. Wasn't Indiana one of the states that like jumped on it originally, or did they actually fight it? Or am I thinking of the wrong state?
You know, I'm not sure. I know that they had Common Core for a year, and then the next year they rejected it.
Oh, okay. So they were the one. I was going to say, because at first I know they took it on pretty readily for the money and everything, and it was just funny that they have some of the more lax homeschooling rules, which is, I mean, good for you. I'm in New York.
Yeah, it's
not very lax here. Not very lax at all here in New York.
Yeah.
No, rubber glove, Vaseline.
Yeah.
A lot of the families, homeschooling families that I hang out with, you know, most of them, I guess all of them, you know, have submitted their forms, have, you know, registered with the state. And so, yeah, it's amazing. Like they
have all the permits to prove your freedom, right?
They're afraid to, they're afraid to do something.
I'm free as hell, man. I got all permits.
State's permission. You know, they're afraid of CPS coming after them. And, and I talk to them, and I'm like, you know, no, I don't want the state knowing what I'm doing. I don't think it's anyone's business what we're doing. You know how we raise our kids, right? That's the parents' business, and that's it. And you know, they can change those regularly. And even people can call CPS on a family. If you listen to Carlos Morales, the whistleblower from former CPS agent, you know, he said most people call CPS for reasons such as homeschooling, cannabis use for the parents, or leaving kids outside, you know, to play for a few hours by themselves. Kind of ridiculous.
How dare you?
Or if they're too skinny or too fat, like ridiculous. And most people think CPS is just for like, you know, physical sexual abuse, but no, that's the vast minority of cases.
Right.
So homeschooling, just the fact that you're homeschooling puts you on an extremist list. We are already extremists just for homeschooling, you know, So even if you do register, so really anybody can call CPS for anything, you know. So I always
figured it was your soul patch that you reason you were on a list.
it's really scary because I joined an Indiana homeschool group, and I was afraid to tell anybody that like we don't have a curriculum, or I call it, when people ask, I say, well, we do a child-led approach.
Yeah.
So which I mean, it's true.
Did you
that face, Jeremy?
No.
Did you join the Raising Common Sense Anarchist group? That's a great group. Let me ask you a more personal question. What about your husband or significant other here? Has he been receptive to these things, or?
Yeah, I talk with him. He learns mainly through me. I wish he would, you know, do more of his own kind of research, but he always like eventually agrees with me when we have conversations. Sometimes he'll get a little annoyed with me, but yeah, he'll eventually think about it and realize that what I'm saying is probably right. But like he grew up in a very, very strict household. So he has a hard time with letting things go with the kids. You know, I let them say no to me, and he does not like that. So that's hard for him.
It's tough.
Yeah, it is. But when you think about it in the long run, like, do you want your kids to not be able to say no to someone because they're an adult?
Right. Yeah. And if you teach them that, you know, you're the authority, you know, you're always right. Do as I say, you know, as I say, not as I do, you know, just respect me, not because of my actions, but just because I'm older than you. What does that encourage? Right. It doesn't encourage, you know, independence, self-reliance.
It encourages
a cycle
of authoritarianism.
Right. Right. And it basically prepares them for government school, you know, the authority.
Well, if they're going to be taken advantage of, it makes it so much easier to be taken advantage of. And that's what scares me, you know, like being, you know, because I let them go out on the street and play, not on the street, but they're allowed to go out without.
With you're hearing it here, folks. She lets her kids play in traffic. All right.
on the highway, right?
And it's, yes.
And she's putting them to work. They're picking up garbage while they're out there. It's okay.
Wait. Now that's child labor.
They're keeping the neighborhood clean. It's okay. Go play, little Johnny. It's all right. Just do some community service while you're out there. It's all good.
Remember, the minimum wage is increasing, so just remember that.
I'm glad you found our show, and I'm glad that we've changed your perception on some things. But the main thing I always stress to people is don't take anything anyone says for stone. Especially at me, but if someone says something to you and it makes sense, don't just go, okay, I'm diving in. Just like, I'm going to study this.
Oh, for sure, yeah.
Somebody says, I'm not sexist, but, you know, you got to question that.
I mean.
Those are the times you don't really have to question, dude.
Well.
You know where it's headed.
Yeah, well, I speak my mind, man.
Well, cognitive dissonance, confirmation bias, it's not, you know, that's not just the statist mentality. It can happen to anybody. That's because that's how most of us were taught. Most of us were taught certain things and pounded into our heads that certain things were true no matter what. So it's like, if these things are supposed to be, you know, your baseline, well, then it's a lot easier for you to be manipulated later on. And even when you find the truth, then it can become very easily for the pendulum to swing the opposite direction for you and to start latching on. And I think that's where you find a lot of the libertarian / anarchists that are, you know, heavily, heavily conspiracy minded, where everything is conspiracy, you know, and they eat everything up, though. They swung in the other direction. They went right past the happy medium, and we're like, no, we got to find, there's truth in everything out there. We got to go get it. And I think they lost sight of the goal there.
Yeah, there was a study. It was on basically saying that when people feel like they have some control over something, they're more likely to, that's not, they're more likely to trust whatever is controlling, actually controlling, and they were I just totally lost my train of thought.
No, no, it's the soft slavery thing. It's let the slaves own their house, but they can't leave the plantation. You know, that kind of thing. That you have control over this house and what goes in it on inside of it, but you can't leave the plantation.
Right.
It's that kind of thing. You know, like we'll let the farmers keep their farmland, but they got to give 50% of their crop to the empire. You know, like I know exactly what you're talking about. It's the illusion of control.
Right. Yeah, they were using it to explain why people believe in conspiracies so much. And he's kind of a really hardcore statist. So I turned it around and I'm like, well, yeah, that's kind of the same thing. You know, if you're letting people think that voting is doing something good for the country, like they're going to let the government do what they want.
Here's the thing.
Imagine
right?
Why.
Government is a parasite. It's a parasite among the productive people. And a parasite's job is to feed as much as it can, as fast as it can, so it can survive to get to the next host. So everything that a government does is going towards that goal, is to keep growing and keep getting bigger. And then they kill themselves. You look every empire, and there's not an empire that has lasted. They all go away. It may take some time, but they all go away eventually. So, like, anything, all these conspiracy theories are just feeding off those things that government has to do to keep itself afloat. You know, like 9/11. Yeah, there's some fucky things that happened with 9/11. We all know that. Mm-hmm. But no one, I think a large majority of the population, doesn't ever want to look at that in a critical light and think objectively towards it and be like, what really happened? They just want to believe the story and move along with their day, because that's easier.
Yeah.
But to sit here and debate on if it was reptiles doing it, or aliens, or Lockheed Martin, or whatever else, like, it goes on to no end, and you can't shore up these ideas or these theories. So, you know, the conspiracy theories, they're neat, and they're cool to kind of dip your toe into, but to go full in on them, it's just, to me, it's a waste of your life. Like, you know, you only have so many minutes on this earth. Don't waste it chasing a rabbit down a hole.
A lot of that's by design, I think. You know, just because a lot of, you know, there's so many. I mean, you can point to ones, historical ones, that are no longer theories. They've been proven to be true. You know, and which lends credence to the newer ones, where more people want to latch on, because I went through that phase where when I first came to all this, you know, in the beginning of my journey, where I, you know, I was into the Alex Jones world for a little while. And, you know, you get so swept up, because once you start learning the actual history, it's like, well, they did this already, why wouldn't they do this? But then you know, stories finally come out of things that people have been saying for years, like the internet trolls. You know, that government shills, that are, you know, people have been saying this for years, and everybody, that was a conspiracy theory. Oh, that's just ridiculous. The government wanted to do that. No, finally, within the last couple of years, that's been admitted in mainstream publications. You know, like the Washington Post had a story on it a couple of years ago, or maybe it was last year. You know, so it's like, there's people out there, disinformation agents, who are feeding the flames of these things. That's what I meant by saying it's done by design, because a lot of people that get so swept up on it, they just buy into all this stuff, that there's out there people, you know, purposely feeding it to them just to keep a certain mass of the people distracted and continue to be distracted. Because when you start, you know, it's one thing if you believe, you know, if you have evidence of other theories in the past that have been proven to be true, and then you have a couple other ones, more recent ones, that you have, you know, that there's a lot of evidence that points that way, and you could say, listen, it's not definitive yet, but look at all this stuff. But when you start pulling out like every story and going, well, here's this and here's this and here's this, you get looked at as crazy by everybody else, and then the disinformation agent has done his job. You know, and that's why Dave, you're saying, you know, it's, they're fun, but there are legitimate ones out there. So it's tough.
I'm not saying there aren't legitimate conspiracy theories, like, you know, Operation Northwoods. There was people crying foul before that got released, and everybody that was crying foul got called crazy, and then it got released, and those people don't get vindicated. They, you know, they get, oh, well, stop clocks right twice, you know. The main thing is when you're talking about conspiracies, especially ones involving the government, you never really meet these conspiracy theorists that want to strike at the root of the problem, which is government. They always want to say, well, if we don't need people in there that are going to do this, or we don't, you know, if it would be perfect. You know, it's not, you can't give people the institution of authority and say, okay, make sure you don't use this wrong. Because it's always, people are self-incentivized in every interaction that they have in life. So it's bound to happen when someone evil or a sociopath gets into a place of authority. There, evil things going to happen. I mean, look at Oliver North. Look at Dick Cheney with all the Halliburton shit. Like, it's just in it. I mean, it's going to happen when you have this. If there's a bike, someone's going to ride it. You know what I'm saying? So everyone wants to say, oh, we got to get, you know, George Bush is a liar and a killer. No. George Bush would never even matter if government wasn't there.
Right.
So, you know, that's always strike at the root, never at the fruit that's coming off of the plant.
Yeah. And the other way that I like to look at conspiracy theorists is, it's not necessary to, you know, dive deep and try to look for something that's, sinister or, you know, backhanded in the shadows. You know, government is out in the open, right? It's stealing people out in the open, right? We're killing people out in the open. We're imprisoning people in the open. That's not, you don't have to search for that, okay? It's like, fact, the United States has the highest prison population. Fact, the United States has the most military bases across the world, right? Fact, the United States have been involved in countless wars since World War II. You know, the century of wars.
Since its inception, what is it? Something like 20 years out of the entire time they haven't been at war.
Yeah, something like that. 20 years of peace and like 200 or something.
Yeah.
Yeah, so these are facts. You know, it's not necessary to go deep into, you know, this obscure government agency did this. And I think that's the more pressing concern is what's happening out in the open. And I guess people, maybe they're not impressed by that because it's just, you know, everybody knows about it, so it's not impressive. maybe they're trying to impress their friends. I don't know.
I feel like government intervention and regulation makes people lazy. Like, they feel like they don't have to look into it because the government's taking care of it, and so you just stay ignorant. You know, you just turn your eye because.
Well, yeah, and that's a big leftist thing. It's like, oh, you tell a leftist, we got to get rid of the EPA, and they're like, their brains explode. You say, oh, there should be no EPA, and they're like, what in the like? If we had a government, the only thing it should be doing is the EPA. I mean, geez Louise, what are you crazy? It's like, well, you know, when you look at the top three polluters in the world, and they're all government agencies, it's like, yeah, I don't think the EPA is going to be regulating them too much.
And there's no understanding of how things work. Like, because I didn't know that. I'm still learning about economics and how politics work. In
so is Danilo.
And
yeah, economics is an awesome topic. I'm fascinated by that. I love that it's. That's one of the ways I talk to people is I, you know, because when you tell somebody you're an anarchist, you know, there's emotional barriers, right? Or you advocate for a stateless society, emotional barrier. So if you say I'm interested in learning about economics, okay, that sounds, it might sound boring, but you know, I like to say precious metals and how that can influence the economy. You know, do you know what gold and silver is? You know what societies have used it. That used to be used as money in this country not too long ago. And so, you know, there's economics, I think, is a wonderful way to introduce people to.
That was in the past, Milo. Quit living in the past, man. We print our money right now, and that's
fiat. Fiat is the future.
It is the future, man. It's the future of tyranny and terribleness. But so today is Constitution Day. If you're hearing this, it's going to be a Monday. Today is Thursday. We record on Thursday, and I guess we could talk about the Constitution. Were you a firm believer? Like, had you read the Constitution before, Amanda?
No.
No, but if someone would have said, hey, we need to get rid of the Constitution, you would have been like, what? No, we need to keep
Right.
her.
Yeah.
I find that's a large, there's this sacred document, and I've never read it, but I know that it's good. I find that that's a lot of what, because I'll talk to people, like, hey, I'm not for this document of slavery called the Constitution. And people will get mad, and I say, well, what's your favorite part? And they're like, the Bill of Rights. I'm like, that's not the Constitution, that's the Bill of Rights.
Well, no, it is the
It got amended in.
I saw somebody have that argument the other day. It's actually true. It is the Constitution because it's just all it is the first 10 amendments, but the amendments are all part of the Constitution. They're not actually separate. They're written on separate pieces of paper, but they're not actually
Well, the
separate
Constitution
documents.
Got made, and
It's
a bunch
special
of
pieces of paper.
a bunch of states wouldn't ratify it until the
mystical parchment is the way I believe I described it this morning in my post.
Mystical parchment, yeah. But like a lot of people have this thing where it's like this whole this a lot of I say it a lot. I say it almost every episode. Everything a government does is constitutional. And a lot of people don't understand that. They're like, oh, the Constitution will protect us from the government. It's like, if you need a piece of paper to protect you from something, I don't think that's going to work out too much. Like, you can't write on a piece of paper, hey, stop mugging me. Oh, shit, sorry, you got that piece of paper. I can't mug you.
Well, you
But
can.
yeah, that's one argument that I've come across a lot. There are people just like, well, this protects me. No, like, do you have someone standing right in front of you, constantly,
like a force field, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's part of the indoctrination. That's what you're taught.
Yeah.
I mean, Dave, what you're describing was basically, it's the bandwagon effect where all these people are just brought over. I mean, a lot of religions the same way. You can, if you're somebody who's, if you're an atheist, then you want to mess with someone who claims to be religious, and you start quoting things off from their particular text that they've never heard before because they haven't read it. They were just taught this abstract idea, here's God, this is what we do. You go every Sunday or Saturday or whatever it is and pray to this person, and this is what you do.
Oh,
So
yeah.
with government's the same way, that you're taught that government's here, it's basically always been here, this is the Constitution, it's a hallowed document, blah, blah, blah. But as you said, I mean, what most people haven't read it because they're just taught it and they just accept it as a truism and they never bother to look into it. And, I think it may be even worse for somebody who has read it and still hasn't become an anarchist, because that was me. I mean, I was a hardcore constitutionalist. I used to read it all the time. And now when I look back at it, especially when I read Article 1, Section 8, I'm just like, I smack my head every time. I'm like, how did I not see that? How did I not see that they're just giving themselves power? That where did they get that power from?
Right.
But most people don't realize. And when you bring that up to them, exactly, their blinders go up. Their own confirmation bias kicks in. It's like, no, I was taught this. Everybody believes this. They can't all possibly be wrong. So you lose.
Yeah, so someone's like, if you could make an amendment to the Constitution, what would you do? I'm like, oh, I would just take out the entire Article 1, Section 8. And then they go look it up and they're like, but then government wouldn't have any money, so it wouldn't. And I'm like, exactly. They would not exist because they couldn't fund themselves. But
Needed a printing press,
Wow. Yeah,
well, no, it doesn't still doesn't work.
Well, actually,
But
I think
no,
it would, right? In the current paradigm, I think it would. I think there'd be enough people
they
that
would have no people.
though
They would have no army.
They have enough
How
people.
many people would take money that's just
The
printed by?
vast
They would have
majority.
no money to build the machinery to print the money.
The
Like
ma-
it doesn't.
The vast majority of revenue is probably from printing. That's it. Like,
Well, yeah,
I think
but
they could do the bailouts by just
the
taxation.
Fed doesn't
No,
print
they
the money
could.
though.
Okay,
the government doesn't print the money. The Fed does.
the vast majority of people, you're
Oh,
missing what I was trying to
you're
say,
right.
Dave. The mass majority of people would say that they want to fund these things. The people that whose minds we're trying to change, they would quite happily fund the government right away again. So I don't think it would be over right away.
That a lot of people won't admit it, but the reason that there's a gun to their head,
Well,
you know,
no, but they'll
yeah, they
also.
would say that, but then 70% of the people are like, I'm not fucking paying. The other people will be like,
If
if they're
there was
not
no
paying,
gun
I'm
to
not.
their head, yeah.
If they're not paying, I'm not paying. So it will
Well, yeah,
go.
eventually, yes, but
But
in
no,
the interim,
you were
I
saying
would just
something
say that.
earlier about the way religion is, and I was watching something about a month ago with Steph, and he was interviewing a Christian or something, and it was he asked him if I had never seen or heard of you know, Jesus or the Bible, would I go to hell? And the guy was like, well, no, you wouldn't, because, you know, you've never heard the message of Jesus. And he's like, so wouldn't you be doing me a disfavor by telling me about it? And I was like, wow, that is a blowout. And I had never thought about that like that. And, you know, it's like, you know, you think about it, like the little kid in Papua New Guinea or wherever, you know, or Cambodia, you know, if they've ever heard of a religion, like, doesn't make sense, you know, like, none of that makes sense. You know, religion is such a regional based thing. Just like the belief in a constitution, you know, you tell an American, you show an American the Iranian constitution or the Russian constitution, they're like, oh yeah, but that's a piece of shit. You know, it's not the American constitution. It's like, well, okay.
That they've never read.
Yes. They've never read.
But we're exceptional. We're exceptional, damn it. So it doesn't matter.
Yeah, we have Donald Trump pulling at 50%.
Don't have to read these things. People much smarter than I have read them, and they said this. So
look, dude, I just want to get in my car, go to McDonald's, and get home. Okay, like that's, you know.
We were talking about like people saying that the government protects them, whichever way that they think it does. Someone actually asked me if in anarchy land, if someone was gonna try to rob their house,
your anarchist world.
Yes. If someone is going to try to rob their house, should they tell them to wait while they go get their knife or their gun? And I'm just thinking, well, that's a lot faster than calling the cops, I think.
I could go rob my next door neighbor right now.
Yeah.
And the cops could not stop that before I got done robbing.
That's, yeah.
So, you know, like, but when you have, like, let's say your entire neighborhood has a contract with a protection agency, and everybody's got silent alarms and buttons around their house that they can just push, and somebody would be there in 2 minutes. I think you could survive for 2 minutes unless someone just came in and guns blazing, but shit like that happens. Like, here's the problem. People that believe in government believe that government can reduce the risk of breathing air and living life, and it can't. That's why they're trying to. They banned firearm ownership in England, or in the UK, and now they're trying to ban ownership, or you can't carry around pocket knives because so many people are getting stabbed because no one's got guns, or shot because no one has guns except for the bad guys. So it's like, at what point do you like you can't walk around with a closed fist because you could kill somebody with that? At what point do you say, okay, there's a fucking line here, government. You need to stop this shit. I want my gun back.
Hey, they're not going to stop until everybody walks around the street covered in bubble wrap.
Bubble wrap. Everyone's going to hook up to the suit. No, everyone's going to hook
hands
up to the
up
Matrix.
Like this, hands up. Walking around.
Did you ever see the movie
Sir? You can nod at people. That's all you can do.
That would be an act of aggression, Jeremy.
Position, right?
Well, exactly. You're not threatening that way.
No, before you leave the house, you actually have to handcuff your hands behind your back and then walk out.
Well, that's just
that silly. That way, if the cops show up, you're just automatically complying and you can't resist arrest because you're already arrested. Have you seen the movie Surrogates? It's got Bruce Willis in it, and it's basically like all these humanoid robots. You lay in like this little like chamber in your room, and you live vicariously through the robot, right? It's a really cool movie, and it's like, you know, like people are just like killing each other's robots and stuff, and so like no one dies, but like everyone's got all these horrible bed sores and shit. Like their bodies are like in, you know, failure, you know, like because they're, you know, they're laying in their bed all day.
So Amanda, let me go back to your what you said that criticism. When somebody tells me that, like, what would happen with a rapist or a murderer or a thief in a stateless society? And I think a good thing to realize is, okay, first of all, does that happen today? Mm-hmm. Is it because it's illegal to murder? Does that mean nobody gets murdered? If it's illegal to steal, does that mean nobody gets robbed? Right? Rape is illegal. So do people still get raped? Okay, that's number one. Number two, where is the most amount of murder? Who commits the most amount of murder? Is it individuals acting individually, or is it people acting under the color of law, right? Or saying, I'm an agent of the state, or I'm a soldier, right? And where's the most rape that occurs? Is it on the street in a back alley, or is it in prison? Right? Yeah. Entirely state.
Yeah, 70% of all rapes in the United States are man on man. And but yet we hear endlessly that women's rights and all this, and women are getting raped left and right. It's like, no, like, well, that's not true.
Well, that's because those dirty criminals, you know, they're in jail.
They deserve it.
Yeah, exactly. They deserve it. They're in jail.
It means they deserve it.
They must have done something wrong. They did something wrong, Dave. They deserve what they get.
They disobeyed a direct command from authority. That's their problem.
If they just followed the law.
If they would, you know, and even then, if you do follow the law, you know, like, if you get put in jail, you should just, you did it to yourself because we are the government, so.
Right. You handcuff yourself.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
You drag yourself away.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I don't understand. Like, you know, the whole thing, like, when you get pulled over, cops, like, hey, look, I pay your salary. Like, that's the utmost true of the situation here. And it's like, you should not be treating me like that. You should be fucking like kissing my feet because your ability to feed your kids is because I pay taxes.
Yeah, I was gonna say that. That's even worse. The cops, like the cop says, I pay taxes too.
No,
that's like. A pool, like getting a cup on one side of the pool, getting it out and walking to the other side and pouring in and go, I filled the pool up.
Well, no, it's that meme of the surge protector, the surge protector plugged into itself. That's what that's how an agent of the state pays taxes. That's how he or she pays his fair share.
So much, and then the government goes, it wouldn't be fair if we didn't take money from these guys too. So they take some of their money back. Like that's.
Yeah, and they give them higher salaries than they would be able to fetch in the free market, so they can collect more money from them. But they also still end up better off because they're willing to play ball and be part of the team. Some of them will take it a step further. Well, I pay even more taxes because I make more money than you. Yeah, you're taking more stolen funds, and then the government is then restealing those stolen funds from you at a higher rate, so you can end up with more. You can end up with more than everybody else. So yeah, that's a silly. Well, most statist arguments, when you break them down, are rather silly. But the one you were describing though, I hadn't really heard it put that way though. That's a whole new kind of potato for me.
Amanda, do you talk to people mostly online about this or in person as well?
It's kind of a mixture. I have a few friends that, you know, I get together with and I talk to them. I sometimes try to avoid talking to them about anarchy, but it always comes up.
Yeah, that reminds me of that meme somebody posted on my wall. It's like, you see, you know, the penguins, like, tries to make small talk, ends up talking about government corruption.
Yeah, I saw that.
I love that.
Yeah, it's hard. And sometimes it can be frustrating because, like, I just want to relax sometimes, you know, and then I just can't let things go when I see a fallacy, you know, I just can't. And I learn a lot from talking with people, even if they're not, you know, on the same page as I am. I learn a lot because I think it forces me to think and forces me to come up with my own solutions. And like when I first started listening to you guys, I didn't have a lot of my own answers. I was like, well, what do you do in this and what do you do in that? And that's part of the indoctrination, right? You don't know how to solve things on your own.
Let the government take care of it.
Oh, yeah. Like I said in one of our early episodes, you know, when I first started hearing about this, the who will build the roads thing fucking slapped me in the face. Like, early, I was like, wait a second. Who's going to build the fucking roads? Like, how are they going to get how is a construction company going to get that much land from so many people that are willing to get, like, and it's like, oh, it'll just happen because.
Oh, thank God for the government.
You know, like in China, like, it's so funny. People are like, oh, communist China, all this. There's major interstates where there'll be a big, like here's the roads and they split out and there'll be a fucking house right in the middle of it. It's because the government can't take people's property away. There's no eminent domain in China to the extent there is in the United States. You know, if you decline the government offer for your land in the United States, they'll just condemn your land and kick you off of it and say, well, you should have took the money. In China, they're like, hey, do you want this money for this land? Nope. Okay, we'll build around it. So now there's people that are living in like houses that are like, there's cars driving by it all day, all night, and they're living there because they refuse that, you know, they've, their families owned it.
That gives a whole new meaning to like letting your kids play in the front yard.
I wonder if the Chinese CPS are like, just,
well, that's,
you better not walk outside.
That's also the other end of the spectrum, though, because a lot of that's another common complaint I hear about, you know, the roads, or, you know, when you say, well, the free market will handle it, and, you know, who will build them? The same people who build them now. People are worried about, you know, people automatically say, well, what if some rich guy buys up all the land around your house and builds a road all the way around it, and then you can't go anywhere and you're trapped there? It's like, what purpose does that serve? Why would anybody do that? And they could, of course, now after Dave saying it, they could point to China. It's like, that's communism.
Uh-huh.
You understand that what we were talking about is not government at all, much less that level of communism. So no, it's not a valid argument. People, you know, it's, I mean, but again, it's, you know, I think we all went through that. You know, you have that question phase where you don't, because you don't know. You're right. It's the indoctrination. You're so programmed to believe that these certain things are truisms. There's no reason to even question them. Government's there. Government's always been there. Government's going to do these certain things. Even if we don't like it, even if we disagree with a particular politician or a particular party, this is just the way it is, and it'll kind of all even out. And we, you know, people are not going, you know, there's just certain things that they, even if they waste money some places, that it's still more efficient than anybody else could do it. So why question it? So yeah, we all start off with that. You know, that's why one of my favorite memes is the one with the giant book where it says, you know, that, oh, my book of what will happen in anarchy if X, you know, finally came in. It's that, you know, the giant encyclopedia that's stacked up on the table. Right, because it is. I mean, we've talked about it before. The first question I tell people to ask themselves if you come to that question, I'm sure I told you that if you ever asked me that question, Amanda, if you had a what if X scenario, the first question you ask yourself is, how is it being done now, and how efficient is it really being, you know, how efficiently is it really being handled? Because most people just assume things are going well, but if you pick any segment of the government, doesn't matter what it is, any agency, any bureaucracy,
they have
anything.
No profit motive.
Well, exactly, but if you just focus on one, because people say, oh, there's too much out there. Well, just pick one. Pick whatever thing actually bothers you about government and go look into the numbers of it and see how efficiently, like see how much their budget is, see how it increases every year, and is there any more?
Things get worse.
Yeah, exactly. Is there any more, or no, not even more? Is it even staying on the same course, or is it getting progressively worse despite how much money? And in almost every single case, you will find the same answer, that's the way it is. So why worry about how would it be when you can already determine,
I mean, unless
empirically,
your worries...
Well, no, you can determine empirically now that it's being done really, really shittily.
No. So... Like, if you're really concerned about the government not killing enough people, like, you could, I mean, they're doing a really good job of that.
Okay, yeah, they are. You're correct. They're very efficient in that.
Thank God we have the war on poverty, because poverty has been increasing since then, right? And of course, it's not,
I mean, yeah, but that's more money for the government because they need to fight it.
Help, right?
That's more money for the government so they can help fight the war on poverty that they keep increasing.
Thank God for subsidized housing, right? And EBT cards. What would they do without it?
Yeah, I was talking to my parents about white flight the other day, or somebody, about how, you know, like a city gets built up, whatever. White flight, yeah, the city gets built up, and then the government goes, hey.
Wait, that sounds racist.
The Democrat gets elected, or whatever gets elected.
It's Dave, you can be assured that it probably is.
No, white flight.
He didn't preface it with, I'm not racist.
White flight's a thing. Google it. But like, you know, like...
Listen to him defend himself, right? No, I swear, it's a thing. It's really a
it
thing.
It is. No, it really is
I'm
a thing.
I'm not racist, I swear.
I'm a little racist, but that's not... I hate unbearded white people, okay? Deal with it, all right?
I'm coming back babyface next week. That's it.
Oh, okay. But no, like, you know, you have a city, they bring in subsidized housing, crime goes up, they get the people making the money get out, and they move away from the city, and all the money leaves the city. You look at Baltimore, you look at Detroit, you look at any place, and it just falls apart, you know? Like, you kill the productive class in an area by bringing in voters that are going to keep voting for your bullshit stuff.
Yeah, Jeremy, you said something before about something about fear. Like, what came to mind was that statism is based in fear, right? Fear of the unknown, fear of the future. You know, if the government wasn't doing this, what would happen? Who would take care of it, right? Thank God for the politician. Thank God for the government. You know, because we couldn't do it, obviously, because government has rights and abilities that we don't have, right? and that's the idea. Statism is founded in fear, right? And this guy I interviewed, Connor Boyack, he wrote his book Feardom. You know, basically how politics controls you through fear, right? War on terror, and you know, you know, hate, you know, fear your neighbor, fear the other, it's a false dichotomy, you know, black versus white.
Oh, you know, Iran, who hasn't attacked anybody in 300 years, they can strike at any moment.
right, yeah, and you know, I mean, not even overseas, but even, you know, fear, you know, the division, people attacking each other, right? Like, you know, old versus the young, employers versus employees, black versus white, illegal versus, you know, citizen. You know, all this kind of class warfare. It's pretty effective in maintaining control and keeping people busy. It's like in 1984. You know, they channel the people's rage at something else rather than the state, right? And that's pretty effective. You know, using fear to control. Fear is a paralyzing emotion.
Danilo, right, so. Do you remember last week when I said the number one issue for voters this election cycle is at an 80%, it was immigration? Do you remember me saying that last week?
No.
No. Well, a new poll just came out. It's 91% now.
Yeah?
Yeah. Okay. So, No.
Thanks for that update, Dave.
we're gonna update it every week until it's. But no. It
Dave's
plays
gonna,
on.
Dave's gonna update it.
No.
Randomly throughout episodes.
No, it fits exactly what Danilo was just saying. They're using that to divide people.
What we need is a wall. That's what we need.
Well, no. Well, that's what Danilo was talking about. I mean, it's divide and conquer. It's been working.
Right.
It's working
extremely well with this immigrant situation.
Yeah.
Well. Yeah. That's just
because protectionism is the foundation for most government, especially for the American government. And you know, people want to protect their land, their heritage, their culture, their race, and they use violence to do that instead of just saying, hey, you know, that's my brother over there, I don't care what skin color he is, you know, Danilo's from Chile or whatever. I don't look at him as some he should go back, like. But you know, like, there's some
that's
people
not what
out
you
there
said
that
before we started recording. But
there's some people out there that I guarantee you would say that guy and his whole family needs to be shipped back because he's not white. And you know, and then what if the Native Americans just started killing people and saying you need to get off our land?
Yeah, because everybody's roots can be traced back to America, right? We were all of our ancestors came from America, right?
Everybody came from somewhere else. That's just
right.
That's just how it works.
Right.
Yeah, but you know, like the idiocy of immigration, you know,
well,
hatred and stuff that gets spawned from it is just it's so mind blowing. You know, like, you look at what's going on. We talked about it last week, but I just read a thing today actually. Denmark closed it, like they cut all of their welfare benefits, and all the people that were going to Denmark for the Syrian crisis were like, hey, we're going to Germany because they give free shit. And it was exactly what I was saying last week about the, you know, like, majority of the reason people are immigrating is because of free stuff. Well, America, juxtaposed to what anybody believes, is the largest welfare state in the world. So yeah. That's why people are coming here, for a large majority of reason.
Right. Yeah. Go ahead.
Well, I just actually, it's funny. I want to bring us back a little bit more to what we were talking about. Although I was going to do a tangent, at least mine was somewhat related. It was just the thing about war. It's funny because, you know, you were talking about, you know, Danilo, you said, you know, the war on terror and the war on this and the war on that. I was thinking about this recently, and I find it really weird. Most people seem to be desensitized to a certain extent to, like, war itself, like actual, like, physical war. you know, mm-hmm. like setting people, yeah. like, you know, I mean, there are the people, you know, there was the anti-war left who seems to have disappeared with Obama, of course. But there are people out there that are pacifists, that have always been pacifists. There's people that have always been anti-war. But for the most part, a lot of the people who think that certain wars are, you know, had to be done, they believe the propaganda they were fed. But they become so desensitized to it, which is why, you know, the whole thing with Syria last year was actually a bit of a shock to even people. Like, I was kind of shocked that enough people stood up and said no, because so many people seem to be desensitized to it. But on the flip side, those same people buy into the war on terror, the war on this, the war on that. It's like, how do they, like, the divide to me seems so weird that they have this, the same word, which is supposed to mean the same thing. A war on terror is supposed to be, we're fighting it, we're gonna win. That's the objective. Like, how do they become desensitized to people dying, but get all ramped up?
Because it's not a war on people, it's a war on idea.
But get all ramped up. But it is, but that is a war on people. That's a direct war on
people. No. Like, people don't, the common statist doesn't see that as that.
But what, they don't, no.
Even they don't see the war on poverty, or the war on drugs, or the war on terror. They don't see that as that's an abstract.
I wasn't talking
about
I wasn't talking about that. I was talking about the physical wars. Like,
I know, but when you say we're going to bomb X country, they see that as much more of an issue than we're going to lock people up and shoot people for smoking drugs.
You're not hearing me. I'm talking about it as being flipped. They're more desensitized to the going and blowing people up.
And I'm continuing on what you're saying. You know,
no, you just said that. You just said the opposite, Dave.
No.
When you just said the opposite, Dave.
The war on Syria. No, I didn't. The war on Syria. The war on Syria.
I had a question, and you're just gonna step all over it. Let's just.
No. The war on Syria.
I get it. You're saying that people, like, you can say, well, we're gonna go bomb these people over here in Iran, and like nobody cares.
Yeah. No. Everyone's gonna flip it if
that's
if somebody.
That's not true.
Goes,
they don't. They see don't it care. As it's protecting them.
Yeah, exactly. But they'll jump on and be all those same people will be all for the war that they the war on people that is unseen, that people don't realize, the one you're talking about. I'm just saying I find it funny that I find it interesting that they're more desensitized at blowing people up versus, you know, oh, it's no big deal. They did something wrong. They should be in a cage for a while. Like, but they're okay with that. But they're just like totally oblivious to the whole, you know, blowing people up.
I see what you're saying now.
All they have to do is film it, Jeremy.
I got some wires crossed.
They see beheading, and it's all over the news, right?
Yeah, I guess. It's just weird. I mean, obviously contradictions are abound with status. Like I said, that one just came up to me recently, and which, since you just mentioned all of those, I wanted to say something about it because I just find it funny. It's like, yeah, war on terror, but war itself, whatever. That's war. It's no big deal. It just happens. It's like, how do you get ramped up for an imaginary war, but you're just like blasé about people getting blown up halfway around the world who you've never met, you'll never most likely, well, now you'll definitely never meet, but you most likely would have never met.
So, yeah, it's, you know, like, you drone bomb a whole village, a bunch of collateral damage. Fine, behead one person. Oh my God, yeah. Those evil savage beasts.
Yeah, it's very...
Did you? I got my wires crossed there. Sorry. No, I get what you're saying, but I think a growing opposition to like a traditional war is growing among the West, especially. You know, I guarantee you, if Britain would have actually been polled during, you know, the invasion of Iraq, hey, do we want to be involved in this? I guarantee you it would have been no, but because they're a treaty nation and a NATO nation, they had to. So, you know, it's one of those things where, once again, we see where representative democracy does not work. Because I guarantee you, even now, like, if there was an amendment that almost got passed in like the 20s or 30s that was, if you vote for war, you also have to sign up for the draft and your kids for the draft, and that got knocked down. But if that would have passed, I guarantee you America wouldn't have been in a war since then.
I don't know about that. I think the powers that be would have just ushered in a lot of people that didn't have kids. And, you know, older generation that couldn't fight anymore, and be like, yeah, now these are your representatives, because they were not going to have to go in anyway.
Well,
Well, and they'll still vote for it.
Have people who are, you know, they're proud of my son represented his country and protected you. And
oh, yeah. I just tell them, you know, what did he protect? The parasite?
Well, yeah. I have people like that in my family. It's so hard to, like, they obviously don't want to talk about things with me. They get very mad, but I'm like...
Have you ever, like, here's what I've been doing, and I'll talk to someone, and as soon as I see them getting mad, I'm like, why are you so mad? Have you ever thought about why this is making you mad? And, like, that's kind of a game stopper right there for people. They, you know, this cognitive dissonance is blowing up their brain, you know, and
yeah.
It's like, could you just pump the brakes and check why you're so mad?
I'm not getting mad.
I'm not angry.
It's not making me mad. Your stupid face is making me mad.
I'm just passionate about my flag.
I get accused fine of being before mad you a lot. Said
that. What's that, Amanda?
Sorry, go ahead,
I said I get accused of being mad a lot.
Yeah.
When I'm not mad.
It's like, how can I be mad if I'm only asking you questions? Because I only ask people questions.
It's because you're reading too much, or you're listening to too many things on the internet. That's why you got to stop. You got to stop that. That's the funniest argument.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just stop reading. Why are you educating yourself? Is that an annoying?
Well, it's because people get scared, Danilo. They just want to bury their head and pretend like everything's okay. And I think that's what's wrong with, sorry to collectivize, but I think that's what's wrong with America right now is no one wants to face the hard facts. You know, like I was talking with my grandfather the other day, and he was talking about, you know, this country's so jacked up and all this, and it was Obama's fault. And I said, not really. It wasn't Obama's fault. I mean, you look at Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, did he put that in office? No, I think you're old enough that you were there when that happened. So
it's your fault, Grandpa.
I said, if damn anything, it's
your fault. Give me his address. I'm going to go over there and kick his ass. It's his fault. Well,
actually, what's funny, when people blame politicians, like they blame one man for everything that happens in the United States, right? That's kind of funny. No, it wasn't one man. He might have given the order, but there was a lot of people under that took the orders and then gave more orders, and then other people followed, and then other people did the dirty work, and then the voters supported with their participation, right? And their encouragement and their belief in authority. So that's really where the legitimacy and the power comes from, right? Is the people. So the one man, you know, he's just a figurehead. He's a puppet. He's the easy one to throw your hatred at, but he didn't do anything. You know, all he did was, get out of bed and write on a couple of pieces of paper with a special pen, and everyone else did the dirty work for him, basically.
It's one man when they're mad about something, but then they'll go and blame the whole system in another situation, and they'll blame voters in another situation. Like, these people didn't vote, you know, this way, so, or these people didn't vote, period. So that's why it's all messed up.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's, I got my dad real, real, real upset one day. I said, you know, aren't you happy? He was complaining about Obama. I said, why are you complaining? You voted, didn't you? And he goes, yeah. I said, then the system worked, right? The people who wanted Obama in won, right? If your guy would have won, you would have been happy about that, right? But you voted, right? And he goes, yeah. And I said, so you consented to the system that put Obama in place? And he's like, yeah. And I said, so you can't be upset because the system is working, right? And I said, and so when Obama gets in, all he's doing is doing what his voters wanted him to do, and also what his donors wanted him to do. Oh. So you can't get mad at the guy because he's just doing what he said, and you consented to it. If you wouldn't have voted, then you could have complained. But since you voted, you consented to it.
Yeah, I get accused because I tell people I'm not voting. And so they're like, well, you're complaining about the system, but you're not going to do anything about it. And as much as I will explain to them, no, like, I don't – people think that not – participating
it's doing nothing,
right?
So it's complicit, it's false, it's faux complicity.
Well, no, complacency, no,
complacent, yeah.
Well, no, it's one of the many false dichotomies that gets thrown at you, and you know, the automatic reaction, well, you if you're not voting, you can't possibly be doing anything else. The same argument where people, you know, a lot of us, I'm sure, I mean, it happens to me all the time, you get accused of, well, you're just, you know, you're talking on the internet, you're not actually doing anything. It's like, okay, no, it's not an either or. It's not like I do things, your cookie cutter way. I don't live within the limits of your imagination, and that means I'm doing something. No, we're out. If having a conversation with anybody, bringing a new idea to anybody, even if it's not directly, like you were saying earlier, you try to stay away from anarchy, but it eventually drifts back to that because because most conversations, once you escape the matrix and once you see the other side and once you have a better grasp on logic and the ability to use it consistently, it's very easy for you to break everything down into simpler terms on the fly so you can look at stuff and be like, okay, yeah, no, you could just do this and this and this. It's very simple. But everybody else is like, no, it's so complicated. It's like, no, it's too much static, too much noise, because that's what you've been trained for. You've been trained in static and noise. You've been trained to be a good, docile, obedient little citizen. That's what the Prussian system was designed to do. It worked to a T here for well over 100 years. You know, I'm a product of that. I got to the party late because I was in my 30s before I finally started figuring this out because it worked that well on me.
I mean, and Danilo voted for Obama, so I mean, go.
You know, are we confessing sins now?
apparently Dave's confessing yours.
Jeremy was begging for a permit for his business that
did not exist. No. Amanda, they say, oh, you're just bitching or you're complaining on the internet. You're not doing anything. And, you know, I mean, right now you're on a podcast and before you had heard what we said, you had never heard of this before, right?
Right.
Okay, so obviously you are one of probably 100 of examples of people hearing the message of liberty.
Right.
And they're changing. And then you're telling other people. Mm-hmm. I see you adding people to our group and saying, be nice. And we are nice in our group. And, you know, it's like, it's if I'm just not doing anything, then why are all these people showing up?
Exactly.
You know, exactly. So those people that are saying that, it's because they drew the last card in the deck and they have nothing else to say. Well, you're not doing anything. At least I'm voting or doing something. No, you casted a vote. Voting is just the advanced auction for stolen funds. So that's all you've done with your voting. So that's to people like that, just send them to this show. Amanda, you're an example of just talking on the internet.
Yeah.
I mean, you've changed your kids. Your kids are going to change. You know, so you told people what?
When they've presented that argument to me, I tell them, no, I'm talking to you right now. Like, and you can either take it and you can run with it or you can ignore it, but it's something. It's definitely not nothing. And I fall into that trap sometimes feeling like, well, this is really not getting me anywhere. And and then I think about it and I think about how I found anarchy and how I've already communicated it with several different people, both in my personal life and people I've met online. And I mean, I believe in people. I think eventually people will realize that peace is better. Or I don't know.
I got a guy who was in the Marines. He's got 5 kids and he was a strict Marine. And I got him to say, you know what? You're right on all this. So that's not only him, but 5 kids.
Yeah.
That's 5 kids. That's 5 potential soldiers firing guns for an evil institution. Mm-hmm. So words on the internet, people that say that I'm not doing anything, they can just literally go fly a kite because I really don't care what they're saying. Right. They're brain dead. They've given up their own critical thinking and their own thought to someone else, to a book, to a flag, to a representative, to a Bible, whatever. They've given it up. They are afraid to think for themselves, and that's what Danilo was saying earlier. Government is based on fear, and that's absolutely true. There's this overwhelming fear that comes upon you when you think about going against the government's wishes.
Yeah.
And even if you're complicit with the government, but the government's out of control, you fear the government then. So you have this whole problem where people are, they're not thinking with their head, they're thinking with their fear. Mm-hmm. And that's what we, you know, we tried to get under and dig that out, kill the tree at the roots, plant a new seed there, and get people away from this. Don't be afraid from anything. If the government goes haywire and kills you, oh well, you fucking died. But you, at least you died trying to live as free as possible.
Yeah. Maybe we should give our closing remarks and wrap it up. But I wanted to say that when I talk to people about these stuff, I like to make it as simple as possible. You know, to avoid all possible confusion, and define theft, define taxation, define terrorism. Define politics, right? So bring it back to the simplest definition, define capitalism, right? Because so many people throw around these words as if they know what they mean, right? And as a result of that, I have written articles with those titles. What is capitalism? What is voluntarism? Because it's amazing how many people throw around these words and they have no idea what they mean. And I go to the Merriam-Webster's dictionary and I say, this is what capitalism is according to that. And I agree with it. I mean, they do mention corporations, but I take that part out. But I agree with what it says, right? It's private ownership of the means of production and goods and services. No mention of government whatsoever. And bring it back to the simplest components. My favorite quote by Confucius is, how's it go? I forget. Stefan Molyneux brings it up a lot. Basically just keep it simple. Keep it extremely simple, because once you go down the road of complexity and these obscure scenarios and you just get lost, and then you go down somebody's mind of like, what if this, what if that, what if this, what if that? It's the huge book that Jeremy was talking about, and you just get lost in the confusion. And no, you got to bring it back to simplicity, right? So that'd be my advice.
You're just oversimplifying things, Danilo.
This is much more complicated. This is much more complicated than that, Danilo. You should know that by now.
Actually, another thing I say, which kind of, they know where I'm going, but then they stop me. I say, so if I steal from somebody, is that immoral? Yes, that's theft. Okay, if a bunch of us steal from somebody, is that immoral? Yeah, that's theft. What if we appoint somebody to steal? Wait a minute, I know where you're going with this. And you're wrong.
You're wrong, because I don't want to think about it.
Because I said so.
Right.
Or more importantly, because my teacher said so. So some authority said so. Some expert. Like I said, you're oversimplifying. Let the experts handle it.
So, Amanda, I really appreciate you coming on the show. If you could tell anybody that would hear this and they're kind of on the fence, or they, they're having a hard time accepting anything that we're saying, what would you say to them?
I would say to, I don't know, they're on the fence. this is a hard one for me.
Well, keep looking.
Way to put our guest on the spot, Dave.
What worked for you?
I just kept thinking about it. I didn't stop. I didn't ignore what I was I was presented with facts, and I didn't just decide that I was going to forget it. Just if you're on the fence, keep looking, keep thinking. Don't trust what other people have told you.
I agree with that, and I ask every guest we have, what's your favorite quote of all time? If you don't have one, it could be anything.
Dreading this, because who did you guys have on last week?
No one.
The week before we had Rayford on the week before, right?
Okay, yeah. Okay, he stole my quote.
Well, say it again. It doesn't matter.
Okay. I don't remember what he said at this point, so it's okay.
Mark Twain, don't let your schooling interfere with your education.
Yes.
That's my favorite quote.
Cool. That's a good, really good quote.
I just remember the Confucius quote, the beginning of wisdom is in calling things by their proper names.
I
thought
that.
It was I can't remember. It's something about
That's
Bangkok.
That's one of my favorite quotes.
It's a good quote.
Stefan Molyneux says it all the time. I'm like, simplify, simplify, always.
People get mad when you do that. People get really angry that
You don't change names. Taxation is a euphemism, right? We're surrounded by Department of Education, Department of Defense. They're all euphemisms.
Mm-hmm. What's one of the first rules of a debate or any logical discourse for that matter? Define your terms. That's where you have to start.
Yeah.
You have to start off.
Definition.
Exactly. So you start off with the because otherwise, if you start off arguing in the middle, then the people are talking about two different things, and which is where you get all the things you were talking about, Danilo, where people they don't have the definition for the word they're using because it's just been told to them so many times in a certain context, with a certain spin on it, and that's all they know about it. So they just attack with that, and then when you ask them to stop and think about it for a second and say, no, okay, let's go back to the beginning. Let's define our terms. What do you mean by this?
Right.
And the more intelligent among them may start catching themselves right there, because once they're forced to think about it, it's like, well, it means, oh wait a minute, that's what kind of happened to me. I fought back hard at the beginning, but it started happening where it was kind of like,
and then you succumbed, right?
Exactly. I succumbed to anarchism. And yes, Dave, I still used it correctly, you bastard. It was sarcasm the first time. It was sarcasm this time. But anyway, I'll just finish up by saying, yes, I thank you for coming on, Amanda. This is actually, I was going to make a joke and say, at least to our naysayers, we have our one fan here. She's come on now, so you can't say nobody's listening. But I said this to you. I think we're officially
a podcast now.
Exactly. We have a proven listener. This is great. But I think I might have said this to you or written this to you when you first came to our group and started talking and said that you would, how you had found us and stuff. And I said that it really, like, things like this, like hearing somebody that we had any kind of positive impact on somebody is a huge deal to me. It's like, holy crap, we started this thing out almost as a joke. Not really, like, we just wanted to, we just wanted to try to put our voice out there and just, see what would happen. We had no definitive plan. Like, Dave had a little experience this beforehand. Danilo's been doing his show. I haven't done jack shit. And on this end,
we're like, can we really use Dave's silhouette as a logo? Yeah, we'll go with that.
We'll
go with that, yeah.
But so the fact that we're actually, here we are 6 months in, we're starting to build a nice little community, I think, in our little Facebook group. I've met a lot of cool people there, and people like yourself who come to us and are like, I learned something from you. It's like, holy crap. Like, I actually, had a hand in teaching somebody something. Like, as a father, I probably shouldn't take as much pride in that because I shouldn't be doing that all the time. But my kids are still young enough. I haven't been able to teach them enough. So it's still like, yay, success. So this was very cool.
They're learning it all themselves anyways.
Yes, exactly. So, but yeah, I just wanted to thank you for coming on because it's a big deal to me that we have people like you out there that we've, like you said, it's a journey and, every little piece of information, you come across it, examine it. You don't, just because you examine something there's another quote that has to do with that, and I'm gonna butcher it horribly, so I'll just say it my way. When it's okay to pick up something and examine it without accepting it. Like, most people are so afraid, they're told to fear certain things, so they won't even look at it. Like, but that goes right to what you were saying about just keep looking, just keep questioning. Never be sure about what you know, because as soon as you're sure about something, you're sure to find out that you were wrong. Just keep pressing and keep asking, and that's, you could be the next Amanda. That'd be really cool for us. So
that it is awesome. We get people that message us individually or on the page, and it really blows us away. It's like, we're just three normal dudes, and that was the our focus for the show, is just three normal dudes, no celebritarians or anything like that, that people like to find problems with them and say, they did this, and it's like, no, we're just three normal dudes.
Except for Jeremy's monopoly on pet sitting, though.
Yeah, he is an oligarch. He is a pet sitting oligarch.
It's true. Well, I was going to say we are three normal dudes, but we do have a celebritarian because Danilo's soul patch.
is the Hingler family going to be vacationing in the Hamptons this year?
No, I'm going to be fighting Barack for Martha's Vineyard. I think I'm gonna try to outbid him this year. So
okay. how is the Rockefellers doing? Are they good? It's your yearly meetup.
Yeah, I told them they had some problems with their dogs. They're not happy with me. So moving on. All right.
Anyways, really appreciate anybody that listened to this. We really, really value you clicking share on this or subscribe if you're watching it on YouTube. And also check out Danilo's show, Peaceful Anarchism. It's a great show. He interviews with a lot of cool people. And thank you, Amanda, for coming on. I know you were kind of camera shy a little bit there, but it takes a lot of guts. And we appreciate you coming on because, you know, your message needs to be heard. People like you need to be seen, in my opinion, because, you know, people see us all, you know, every week they see us on the show, but when we bring in a fresh face and you say, hey, look, these guys change the way I think about things, it really, people say, wait a second, you know, I'm a normal girl from, you know, Indiana or where, you know, I'm just a normal person. Why am I not getting it, you know? And they'll start digging as well. So, you know, it's awesome. It truly is awesome.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Amanda.
Yeah,
it's awesome. Thanks a lot for coming on. So if anybody wants to donate, we accept Bitcoin, PayPal, or you can click on the Patreon link in the description below. Throw some Federal Reserve notes while they still have value before the Federal Reserve prints the hell out of them. We can use them for something, right? Thank you very much. Yeah. Or bullets or gold and silver or whatever you want to send through the mail. You're welcome to try to use the USPS. Do not trust them, but what can you do? They have a monopoly. So thank you very much, everyone, for listening. This is the Seeds of Liberty podcast. Wishing everyone have a wonderful day. Take care.
Peace.
Bye.